this is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you and where I am in the world today. I'm in here in sunny Southern California. And it's a very exciting and special episode for me because actually I'm visiting another literally famous YouTuber's house. And so the YouTuber I'm visiting today, her YouTube channel is called Wendi Land. She also runs a website, wendiland.com. You can learn more about her there and check out her videos. But basically, I met Wendi actually at the Heirloom Festival 2017, and check the link down below for my video review of the Heirloom Festival. It was an amazing event. I didn't get to go to many talks at the Heirloom, but one of the talks I went to was her presentation, and it was an amazing presentation all about edible leafy green vegetables from her country. You know, she is an American citizen, but she's originally from Vietnam. That's where she was, I think, born and raised. And many of the things that she grows is actually common to her, and she knew as a child, you know, some of these little fruit berries that she ate that tasted like cotton candy were like grown in Vietnam. And now, because she's in an amazing climate here in Southern California, where she gets down to maybe 34, 36 degrees on a cold day in the winter, that's like the coldest it gets, except for the rare day, she's able to grow some of these very tropical, edible, leafy green vegetables and also herbs, as well as some amazing different fruit trees. And so the reason why I wanted to come here is because she's so knowledgeable about some of these traditional, you know, vegetables that she's grown and have eaten literally throughout her life. And most Americans that are not Asian of descent, I mean, even some Asians, depending on where in Asia you're from, may not know about some of these. And some of these vegetables are very important. You know, they have very researched healing properties and can be very helpful. You know, some of the plants you'll see in this episode are, you know, have documented studies for things like blood sugar regulation, you know, cancer and diabetes and all this kind of stuff. So what I want to do in this episode is actually show you guys what Wendi's growing. So you guys are overlooking her front yard here, and you can see she has a lot of edibles. Not everything's edible like in her front yard like mine, but she's growing quite a lot of edibles, and she's making really good use of the space. I mean, if you just drove by this house, you wouldn't know that like most of the things in the front yard are edible. And you know, this is what I want for all you guys. I mean, I'm looking here, actually the lawn next door is a brown lawn, not watering it. There's a couple of regular green lawns, but you know, why not make the best use of your space? You know, you can't, well, you could eat your grass, but most people are not eating their grass, but we all need to eat every day. So she's using her front yard in a way that's very, you know, beneficial, you know, because she gets to actually grow some of the food that her boyfriend and dog are eating. So anyways, let's go ahead and first we'll give you guys a little tour of what's growing in the front yard, and then we'll get into the more interesting parts of some of the more medicinal plants and edible vegetables from Asia she's growing in the backyard. So the first thing that Wendi's growing in the front yard, which I would encourage you guys to grow in your front yard because, you know, generally even if you have like restrictions due to your city laws or homeowners restrictions that you can't have a vegetable garden, in many cases they don't include fruit trees because, you know, everybody has trees. Just because your tree happens a fruit once a year, maybe more often than that, you know, you could get away with having some fruit trees in your front yard. She has no restrictions here, luckily, but she is growing fruit trees in her front yard. She has a nice papaya over on this side, and then over on that side she has a nice pomegranate, which actually has nice big palms. Actually, and the funny thing about Wendi is that, you know, when I seen her videos, I thought she's like pretty tall, but actually she's quite short in real life. So she has to get her boyfriend to like help her pick some of the taller stuff. I said you should get like one of those pole pickers. But and besides that, she also has like a dwarf banana. So like, you know, that's for dwarf sized people. Dwarf bananas, you don't gotta reach up super tall to get them. And then also she has like a cherimoya. So yes, yeah, so fruit trees that are proper for your climate, I always recommend for your front yard. You know, I have many fruit trees in my front yard just because, you know, they fill in nicely. I like to plant fruit trees actually along my borders between my neighbors. So, you know, that kind of keeps some privacy. But also, you know, since fruit trees grow up and then they basically generally branch out depending on the tree you have, you know, that's generally leaves the bottom area open for you to grow more food. And that's exactly what she's doing here, you know. She has the fruit trees growing on top, and then below the fruit tree, she has many different things growing. So let's take a look at what she has growing below the fruit trees that are actually edible and useful.
So immediately down below the fruit trees, I guess mainly in the front border, she's trying to grow a bunch of like flowering plants, whether that's the flowering cactuses, which are really nice and beautiful. They're also edible, the cactus pads, as well as the cactus fruits. She also has some flowers that are actually non-edible, but then this one I learned about today, she said the periwinkle, and I didn't know this, she said the flowers are edible. So like these periwinkle flowers, she said they're like anti-disease, maybe like anti-cancer. They're nice and cute, but then I'm like, oh, these are nice, cute, they should taste pretty good. So then I basically just plucked off all the petals and ate it. And when I ate it, I was like, man, these taste like really strongly bitter. Unless these were candied, I wouldn't want to eat them. But I guess because they have like medicinal properties, you know, some things that have medicinal properties, they're not always tasting so sweet. So it's always good to try to find a balance between like, you know, taste is good and also, you know, beneficial for your health. These ones, I probably won't be eating any kind of any of them in large quantities. The periwinkle, they just don't taste so good. But let's go to some other things she's actually growing right behind the periwinkle that actually is edible, both the greens and also the tuber it creates. So probably the dominant crop she's growing here in the front yard are sweet potatoes. As you guys can see, they got all these sweet potato vines. They also make these nice sweet potato flowers right here. And she estimates that she has about at least 20 pounds of sweet potatoes growing under the ground here in the front yard. But just having some nice sweet potato vines in the front that to me look very ornamental, right? I mean, there are non-edible versions of sweet potato vines that are growing just for the looks. You know, she keeps this really neat and trimmed back. I don't know if you guys can see, but she has a nice like graveled pathway that kind of winds through her whole front yard. Actually, I thought that was quite decorative and quite nice. And then she actually has this trim back so that, you know, the plants are not overcrowding into the gravel walkway. So she has a whole bunch here and she has a bunch in the back. Actually, she has two different varieties. And I like that she tends to try to grow like varieties that are really colorful. So like she has like a nice purple variety of sweet potato that she's growing here. And they grow year round for here in Southern California, you know. And especially if you're kind of looking for something as a ground cover, I think this is one of the best things you could do in a tropical location. For those of you guys that aren't lucky enough to live in a place that you know, doesn't freeze like the rest of us, including me, this would be a good summer crop provided you get the heat. You know, the sweet potatoes really love the heat. You know, I've been to places like South Florida, Hawaii, Southern California, where sweet potatoes do great in climates like mine. You know, I like to just grow them, you know, after the last frost and before the first frost. You know, they grow fine in the summer season. But you know, I'd rather have one that's more maintenance-free or less maintenance in general, like she's doing here. So that's really great. She also has some aloe veras growing. You know, I really like aloes. Be sure to check the link down below on my aloe video. It's like one of the most watched aloe vera videos on YouTube on how to properly prepare your aloe for eating. You know, I really like that she has a lot of, you know, some common but many uncommon crops that you may not learn about. Anyways, let's go ahead and take a look at two more crops she's grown here in the front yard. So this is a pretty effective use of space right here. Check it out. Above here, we got pomegranates that are actually ripening and she needs to be harvesting some of them because some of them at the top are already splitting. Maybe I'll get lucky and get to take one home today and eat it. But below, as I said, she has all the sweet potatoes, which are a starch-based tuber, right? And you know, it's one thing for growing food for fun, growing food for nutrition, but it's a whole nother level to grow food for sustenance. And you know, one of the best foods to grow for sustenance are some of the starch-rich foods, especially some of the starch-rich storage tubers. You know, so sweet potatoes, really excellent. Potatoes, another good one. But aside from that, another one that's really good are the squashes, right? Here she has a squash growing. You guys can see, I don't know what kind of variety this is. She doesn't actually know either because this came up as a volunteer. She composts sometimes in place in her front yard where she lets the worms get up in there and all kinds of stuff. And she had two squash plants come up, which actually looks, you know, it blends in really nice to her front yard. But also she's growing a lot of the food. So she could cook up these squashes, which are another starch source. Which, you know, if you look at it around the world, literally starch-based diets dominate literally the world, and ancient cultures, they lived on starch-based diets, whether that's, you know, sweet potatoes, people from the Incas, you know, on things like corn or rice, something like that, or even, you know, the squashes, right? These are real nutritious foods, and when I want to encourage you guys to grow deep, rich, pigmented squashes and sweet potatoes, or just regular potatoes, right? Like she's doing here, the purple potatoes, besides having the carbohydrates to feed us, to give us energy, also have the phytonutrients that are anti-disease and disease protective. Same thing with the squash. You know, some of the squashes are deep, rich, you know, orange colors that have rich beta carotenes. And also the squashes, you know, that could store. You could grow them during the summer, and you could store them and eat them over the winter time. So yet another valuable thing she's growing. And even if she grew something like the Seminole pumpkins, right, that they grew in South Florida, those will grow as a perennial, and she could have pumpkins all the time to eat. So yeah, two valuable crops for more than just nutrition, but for survival. And yeah, and then pomegranates growing above, and yeah, so many other things. Let's see, I think I want to cover like one other cool thing. Oh, she's got a papaya here in the front yard too. I want to cover maybe like two herbs, and then we're going to hit up the backyard, which is where all the magic happens. So one of the cool things actually about this video that I just thought about and wanted to share with you guys is, you know, if I don't have enough information on any of these one crops that you guys are watching in my episode, be sure to check Wendi's channel. I'll put a link down below in the description of her channel, because I'm confident that she has like in-depth videos on many of these specific plants she's growing. And that's actually one of the reasons why Wendi's channel is one of the handful of the other gardening YouTube channels that I actually watch on a regular basis, right? She has really good content. I really like her content. Number one, they're shorter than my content, so you guys could stay tuned and watch the whole thing. Number two, she has lots of good information, you know, and she's really nice and personal, and actually a pretty good gardener by the looks of her place. So yeah, be sure to check her channel for other videos on some of these specific crops that I may just be glossing over in some instances. Anyways, in this part of her front yard, she has this guy right here, and basically it's just like a basil that's setting seed. But don't worry, even if this basil sets seed, it continues to grow. I mean, I look down at the bottom of the clump, and there's like a literally a tree trunk like that big around of this basil. And this is a holy basil. So this is the holy basil, and she finds that this basil, unlike others, will grow year after year, and because there's no frost here, it stays alive. She hasn't had luck with some of the more culinary basils that she does grow in the backyard, but this one stays alive year round. Plus it's also the holy basil, which is a more medicinal style basil, and I tasted the leaves earlier on it, and it has a nice strong flavor, and actually I like it a lot. You know, I'm used to some of these strong, unique, and even bitter flavors because I know they're healthy for me, and I'm like, yo, these are bitter, I spit it out. Like, I have friends like that, and I want you guys to get used to the bitter flavors. You know, the more you guys eat bitter flavors, the more your body is going to be accustomed to it. Not to say that everything that is bitter is good, because of course there are definitely bitter plants that are actually not good for you and quite poisonous. So before you eat any plant, including some of the ones that I'll be showing you guys in this episode, be sure to do your own research and do what you feel comfortable with. Everything I do in this video, you know, I personally feel comfortable with, and I would do. And you know, once again, I'm coming here and eating a leaf here, a leaf there. I'm not eating large masses of quantities of some of these more medicinal style vegetables. So please do your own research and make sure what you're eating is all right. If you are growing some of these for the first time, I do recommend starting slow and not eating any large quantities of any one particular kind of green until your body gets used to them. So a good way to do that is just, you know, have a big lettuce salad and have, you know, a couple of these more medicinal, maybe stronger tasting, maybe bitter leaves added into that salad, so that, you know, they're really diluted down. You're not just eating, you know, salads with a lot of these, you know, more medicinal style leaves, including the holy basil. And then besides the holy basil, if you guys could see behind, she has like a big banana. So this is actually a dwarf banana. It's not currently fruiting right now, and she said the fruits actually didn't taste too good. They were more kind of starchy. And I said, well, usually if that happens, you need to kind of like let them up, ripen up more like a plantain. You could eat plantains when they're ripe, they're not starchy, but they got to be almost like black, like they're like looking like you need to compost them, right? And then they finally, the starch, you know, turns into sugar basically after a long time. Otherwise, they're a good cooking banana. So she's thinking about like maybe pulling this one out and replacing it with some other better bananas. And then also she has some tomato plant. And you guys can see this tomato plant right here. I mean, it's kind of cool how she has her front yard. It's kind of like all like in some ways wild, but it's wild, but it's trimmed properly. So like it's not falling out. It looks like proper. It looks really good because it's just plants have filled in. And so I kind of like this gardening style in some respects, as long as it looks fairly neat, especially in a neighborhood where everybody has like nice manicured lawns. But yeah, she has a tomato plant, and she said she's like having some challenges because it had like the heat of the summer, and it looks like to me that she has some spider mite damage, although it's still producing pretty good. And I'm like, you know, and she's complaining, oh, how hot it is. I'm like, you try living in Las Vegas, and then you complain to me, because her tomato plant looks amazing here, still with plenty of tomatoes. Anyways, the next thing I want to do is actually head to the backyard and show you guys some of the more medicinal Asian vegetables and herbs. So now I'm about to head through the back gate right there, which goes to the backyard. But before I do, actually, I want to stop here and let you guys know that you guys should grow something like this, or what Wendy's doing. You know, as much as I love my edibles and she loves her edibles, she has many other plants, actually way more than me, that are actually not edible. I wouldn't want to waste as much space. But, you know, there can be some plants that are actually quite beneficial, not only for you, but also nature, right? So such as this one, this is the milkweed. So this is like, you know, good for the butterflies, you know, as butterfly food, right? I also want to encourage you guys to have other, you know, select native plants and flowering plants that'll be good for pollinators, right? Because if you attract some pollinators to your garden because of these, they'll also stay in your garden to pollinate your vegetable plants. In addition, other, you know, certain native flowering plants could be good to basically attract beneficial insects to your garden that are going to eat the bad insects that are actually in your garden. So, you know, as much as I'm trying to be like focused, like I just want to grow food and use all my space, you know, think on how you could use, you know, I don't know, maybe 10%, 20% of your space, or even fit in some, you know, plants like this and maybe a more non-desirable spot. I mean, if it was me, I'd put a fruit tree here and then maybe I'd have the milkweed grow below it. You know, grow some stuff for nature as well, because that in the end will help you, your garden, and also the planet. Anyways, let's head into the backyard. So the amazing thing about how Wendy's growing many of her plants actually is actually in pots, you know, so she has like, you know, many different shelves, tables, racks, where she has a lot of different pots, and she's growing some of these plants just in pots. So, you know, this even though she owns this place or whatever and can be planted in the ground, a lot of it is actually concreted in. She doesn't have a lot of space to do that. Like, I'm standing on a concrete pad here, which looks like it would be good for an RV if they had one to pull in on the side of the house. But, you know, you can't plant on concrete. So basically, she has like tons of pots like everywhere, growing all kinds of different things. So she has lots of different potted trees. Let's see, some maybe like guavas here, and some Suriname cherries over here. Actually, the black one, which I like a lot. Maybe you like some citrus over there. This tree here, I don't know if you guys can see that there. It's really, really interesting. The leaves fold out when in their sun. I think it's some kind of gooseberry, Indian gooseberry maybe. And then she also has this guy right here. And actually what this guy is this something I learned about. It's actually an African bitter leaf plant or tree. And you know, this tree is really interesting. Let's see if I could pull some over for you guys to show you guys. So this is what it looks like. I've never heard of this before, but she said you could just literally pick the leaves and eat them. So, you know, I'm all into plants that have edible leafy greens. I mean, after all, my channel is called Growing Your Greens, and it's called Growing Your Greens for a reason. I want you guys to grow basically plants that you could eat the leaves off of. Because number one, that's leaves are the easiest things to get the plant to grow, right? You don't have to wait for the plant to grow all its leaves and then to make a fruit and all this kind of stuff. It just grows the little leaves like this, and you pick them and then you eat them. Also, some leaves, you know, have very medicinal properties. You know, this one I'm sure has very many good medicinal or benefits, medicinal benefits. I don't know what they are yet, but we'll be asking her in a little bit. And this is what the leaf tastes like, or looks like. I'm going to taste it now. I'm just tasting it. This is something that you guys would not want to taste it. I mean, I'm pretty good with bitter stuff. Take a dandelion, and many of you guys have eaten dandelion, and times that by about 20. That's how bitter this thing is. Doesn't taste good. But hey, what if this thing is anti-cancer and you eat a leaf a day and you don't get cancer, right? I think so many people do things that promote cancer in their daily lives, you know, using like artificial like chemicals, whether that's, you know, in their garden or even in their home for cleaning products, for, you know, body care products, eating processed foods with all these different chemicals that could cause cancer. So many different things that could cause cancer. We need to do things that are actually anti-cancer in this day and age. So, you know, this plant as well as many other plants, I mean, even more common vegetables that you grow, kale, collard greens, broccoli, cruciferous vegetables, onions, garlic, allium family plants. These are all very powerful anti-cancer foods. I think the next thing that's really important for a lot of people, especially as they get more mature, is their brain and brain health and being able to remember things. I know my dad is actually having some challenges with his memory these days, and maybe this next herb from Asia would help him out. So as you guys could see, literally on both sides of me, over on this side and over on this side, we have an Asian herb that I've known a lot about, and I've grown actually myself before, and I think I'm still currently growing it. It's known as Gotu Kola, and it said it's good for your memory. And as you guys can see, it just literally grows in. This is a ground cover, growing in really well. In some areas, like in Florida, it could grow as a weed, actually. I think when I went to Costa Rica, it was actually growing as a weed, or basically just in the forest. When I was on a ropes tour, and I saw it, and I'm like, I knew what it was, and I just stopped and started eating it. And it's so delicious. It could taste so good. One of the things I learned today is actually she grows it in a place that actually gets up morning sun only, you know, not too much sun, and also likes to stay pretty moist, you know, doesn't like to dry out too much, right? And so this area over in this patch on this side basically doesn't quite as get as much runoff water as the ones over in this back section that's actually near a whole bunch of these potted plants that get a lot of runoff water. So this side is getting a lot, you know, more sun in the morning and also more moist. It's doing really well. Now, I do want to let you guys know that a lot of the plants that I'll be showing you guys today are tropical plants, meaning if you live in a place that gets a frost, these ones will not grow year-round. So you could grow them, you know, in the warm season, like when you would plant your tomatoes out. You might want to do cuttings, pot some plants up in pots or containers, bring them inside, put them in a greenhouse that's going to stay warm during the winter to keep them alive, or just get new plants every summer season when it's warm. You know, in this climate, grows year-round. In Northern California, when I grew the Gotu Kola, it also grew year-round as well. So now I want to share with you guys actually another potted plant. And you know, it's amazing that she's growing many things in here, even though she has limited amounts of backyard space, which she is growing in. She has many things in pots, and this could be especially valuable for you guys if you guys don't live in a climate where you could grow year-round in. You know, for example, you could grow things in pots and then take them inside, put them in a garage, you know, that's heated with some lights on it to keep them growing in the winter time so that you can bring them out next summer when it starts to warm up, or bring them into a greenhouse, a heated greenhouse, or depending on where you live, it could be an unheated greenhouse that just does not freeze, so some of these guys can stay alive. Furthermore, if they're in a pot, you could easily move the plant, right? This can be quite beneficial, especially if you're not familiar with the plant that you're growing, right? Over here, she has the Okinawan spinach, also known as the Janeiro bicolor. And you know, she was growing this in a place and it got pretty good shade with a little morning sun, and then she actually had to move it, and then she found out that, you know, if it got too much sun, it started burning. So I want you guys to kind of be aware of your plants, how they're doing, right? And always, you know, err on the side of caution, right? If you think, hey, this plant, I think it's getting too much sun, it's having some burnt leaves, you know, move it into a shader spot, see how it does. I mean, half the whole process of gardening is like learning your plants, you know? I mean, I had some of the Okinawan spinach, like at the end of last year, I basically potted it up. It went into my greenhouse because it can't survive the frost, and it did great in the greenhouse. It loved the greenhouse in an unheated greenhouse. It's kind of in a more shady spot. It gets indirect sunlight for me, right? And then I did a cutting of it, actually earlier this year, and I planted it out next to my my other Janeiro, my Janeiro procumbens or longevity spinach. And it was in full sun because I was like, oh, the other Janeiro likes it. Let's see if this guy does. Nope, it didn't like it. Totally burned up, right? And so like, oh, I learned. And then I learned from Wendi that, hey, doesn't like full sun. So, you know, hey, shame on me. But, you know, that's how we learn in gardening. We're all going to make mistakes. Nobody's ever perfect. Not even me. I totally mess up sometimes. But I want you guys to learn from your mistakes. So this Janeiro, I believe, is probably like the one that we'll be looking at next, which is actually good for lowering your blood sugar, right? And yeah, so she has like one of these plants, but the other one she really likes a lot more because literally it grows like a weed. So where I'm at now is I'm in actually her alleyway on the other side of the house, and on one side of me she's got the house, and then over on this side there's a big brick wall, so we're sitting in an alleyway, you know, yay wide. And we have like, there's all this greenery that kind of like, you can't see the depth because this is only a camera, it's like a single plane, but it kind of like goes up. And to me, it reminds me of kind of like this one big vine that just kind of comes down, or like Rapunzel when she let her hair down or whatever, out of the castle so somebody could climb up. Was that Rumpelstiltskin? I forget. but anyways, this is like one big vine of like edible leafy greens. And what we're looking at primarily on the bottom here are all these guys. And these guys are known as Gynera procumbens, also known as longevity spinach, in some places also known as Chinese spinach. And these guys I love a lot. Nice mild flavor, really neutral flavor, but this is a medicinal leafy green vegetable, right? Said to be good for lowering your blood sugar. In addition, she has this guy on top, and this is known as the grass jelly. And I've never heard of this before, right? I learned about this actually at her talk at the Heirloom Expo, so I like wanted to definitely get down and see how it grows, which it literally grows like a weed after seeing this guy. I mean, look at this. I'm pulling it up. It goes all the way back there. And the plant's like way back on the other side or something like that. And she has like multiple planting these guys all around her yard, but definitely the Gynera procumbens, longevity spinach, she has mass quantities of. In addition, if you look really closely down in here, you could see, and if I don't get poked here, she's got a dragon fruit vine just totally vining out. I mean, some of the dragon fruit vines is like vining up her neighbor's tree that's like next to the fence. It's kind of cool to see that up a cypress. But yeah, lots of edible stuff going on, even without a lot of work. So this is probably my favorite area of Wendi's backyard, which is basically, part near the backyard, actually, that starts to go towards the front yard. It's basically the house on that side and her fence on that side. It's probably like at least maybe 10 feet wide right here. You can see she's got a nice big banana plants right here, and you guys can see some bananas right here. And then over on this side, for the most part, she has a few things in the ground, but most things are actually just potted up in pots. So I'm going to go down the line and share with you guys some of these plants here. And then actually over on the back side, on the wall side, she has a whole bunch of different plants growing as well, all really easily. Some under the shade of some trees here, and some not. So actually, let's go ahead and show you guys what's grown over here. So the first plant I want to let you guys know about is this guy right here. In English, anyways, it's called the grass jelly. I don't know the Vietnamese name. There's probably Vietnamese names to these. But it's definitely not a grass, but I guess they classify things as either a tree or a grass or something like that. But actually, this plant, it has like these little leaves, which I learned that you can't actually just pick them off and eat them. It's kind of good. The smaller tender leaves near the end are the best. If the leaves are more mature, they're more fibrous and maybe not quite as good for eating, but that's how they're actually used in traditional Vietnamese cuisine. They basically just take the leaves and they basically like blend them up with a little water just to get it going, and then you put it in like a cheesecloth bag or nut milk bag or paint strainer bag and strain it out, and then it gets like this jelly type stuff, kind of like almost like jello. Maybe it's a natural jello. I've never really done that, but Wendi has done that for me today, so maybe we'll take a look at what it looks like when she does make the grass jelly, or the jelly out of grass, which is quite interesting. And then over here next, I don't know if you guys could see that, but yeah, you guys can see this. Over here, instead of the grass jelly, this is actually called snake grass. Now, yeah, this is not really a grass, that's just the English name for it. But anyways, this one also has edible leaves, and it's cool when I find new edible leaves I can't eat. That's this guy right here, snake grass. I'm gonna eat one. This one has a little bit stronger flavor than this guy, grass jelly. And the snake grass is said if you like get a snake bite, you're supposed to like, you know, put some of this poultice on your skin. It's supposed to draw out the venom. Don't quote me on that, but if you have snakes, you might want to grow one of these guys. I would just personally grow it because it actually doesn't taste too bad, and I could eat it as another leafy green mixed amongst all my other leafy greens for some of its medicinal properties. And hopefully later I'll be asking Wendi about some of the medicinal properties of some of these very plants. So another plant that I want to share with you guys is actually this guy. In English, it's known as wild betel, and it's in the piper family. And it's not the betel leaf plant. This is a different variety. This is the wild betel that's used more for culinary uses. I think traditionally they use it to like wrap things and cook things in. But of course, you can eat the leaves. And once again, you know, especially if some of these plants, I want to encourage you guys to pick the smaller, more tender baby leaves. Let's see if I could find one back here. Here's a small one right here. And we're going to try this. Definitely has a unique flavor. On some levels, reminds me of like a basil with a mixture of like water pepper. It's got a tad a bit fiery, tad bit bitter, but overall it's a nice flavor, right? This one in South Texas anyways, because I planted one actually for my girlfriend's parents in South Texas, and it grew like a weed literally, and it like took over. So be aware, she planted it once, and I think she planted it like originally over here, and somehow it got like all the way up over here, so it kind of runs. But you know, having more food growing is a good thing, especially if you kind of do more wild style permaculture, right? Because these are perfect permaculture plants, you know, for Southern California here, that where you don't get a frost. Now, one of the cool things I was able to try today, and I'll do it again for you guys, and I don't know if this is officially edible, but you know, I like trying stuff and being daring, and I feel comfortable with what I do, and if I get any negative repercussions, I take full responsibility. I do not encourage you guys to do this. But this is like a little flower bud, and generally, but not always, if the leaf of a plant is edible, the flowers should be edible, and the flower bud may also be edible, but don't quote me on that one either, because there's always exceptions to every rule. But this is what this looks like, little flower bud, so I'm going to go ahead and eat this. So the flower bud thing, it's kind of like nice and crunchy. I really like the texture. You get like a flavor explosion, so it's kind of like if you eat a Spilanthes flower bud, it's kind of like a similar, Spilanthes is a little bit softer, but you get that explosion. This is not quite as like hardcore Spilanthes that sucks the saliva out of your mouth. It's kind of a, like a nice like flavor, like the leaf kind of times 10. So like a lot more the, you know, chemical or phytochemical plant derived chemical constituents that have the anti disease effects like blow up in your mouth. You know, I think it'd be really cool to like take some of these little buds and like chop them up or put them whole in the salad, so when you're eating your salad you just get like a flavor explosion. You know, I think that's some of the best ways to use some of these medicinal plants in small quantities, but you know, on a fairly you know, regular basis. Like if I grew this, I'd have leaves maybe once or twice a week, and maybe some of these little flower buds, you know, once or twice a week also. So the next plant down the way is literally the Gynera procumbens again. You know, I mean, it was vining out, as you guys saw, down the alleyway more that way. But right here, I mean, what she did was actually she uses tomato cages. You guys could see the cages. And, you know, the Gynera procumbens tends to, like, fold over, and they try to creep and run on the ground or whatever. But as she noticed in the tomato cages, it kind of keeps them growing upright. So I think that's a really good thing to do. This year, actually, I grew the Gynera procumbens or longevity spinach actually up a trellis. So I just trained it to go up the trellis. And then what I found was that actually I trained it up, and then it actually started shooting out leaves towards the sun. And I have it actually in full direct sun, which it takes for no problem whatsoever. But yeah, she has lots of these leaves to be growing, and also to be doing the propagation from, because they're all propagated not by seed, but by literally cuttings that you would just basically cut off the plant like this and break off all the leaves, maybe keep a few at the top. And you could just stick this into water, actually just like that, and it'll actually grow new roots. So if I bury this, you know, it might just grow new roots and actually start a whole new plant. So I'm really amazed at how many potted plants Wendy's growing. I mean, here's just a little pad outside, like a door that leads to the backyard. And a lot more potted plants. I mean, just in this area, she has four more potted plants. And mainly in this area, she's growing these guys right here, which is the Galangal ginger. You know, I also grow Galangal ginger. I've had no problem growing it year-round in my climate in an unheated greenhouse. She's able to grow it in her climate in an unheated outside conditions because it doesn't frost here. But I think this guy is a little more frost tolerant than the standard ginger, which is more of a true tropical. But nonetheless, you want to protect it if it gets too cold. She's just growing it in pots, and you know, when the pots get too full, she'll basically divide them. This guy's in a pot, and it's actually pushing roots out the side. I could totally feel the roots coming out of the side. And so she divides them. She says that these guys don't like direct sun, like an indirect sun, and that's why she has them here over in the shade. And of course, you know, once again, in a nice, maybe like a 5-gallon pot. She's growing a nice Jonera Procommens. I think this is probably one of her most favorite plants.
So Wendi, like me, stacks in her plants. I mean, she's got these plastic shelving units, some of which maybe might be overloaded a tad bit, but that's all right. But she has several of these just so she can actually have more potted plants and so she could grow more vertically, you know, especially some of these plants that actually don't grow too tall to run into the roof of the or the next shelf here. They could grow out, or she can move them up to the top level that can grow a lot larger. So here she has this guy. It's a Chinese immortality herb. I think it's called a jigluan or something like that. And then up actually over here, this is called the leaf of life. You know, I've seen these grown before, and she's telling me these are edible, so I never knew about that. But I did, and the cool thing, propagating these guys are really cool. You literally just take a leaf, and you drop a leaf down, and the leaf will actually just start to germinate. So actually here's, I can show you guys this. So this is the plant here. And a leaf actually dropped to the ground right here, right? And check out this leaf. Out of the leaf started a little new shoot, and if I tried to pick this leaf up, it's actually rooted itself already down on the bottom. This is totally amazing, propagation by leaf. So you just literally need to get a leaf of this, drop it in the ground, water a little bit, and actually it's gonna shoot up a new plant. I mean, I've never seen that before, but this leaf of life literally, you know, has medicinal properties. Supposedly, and you could eat these leaves raw. Never knew that. I think it's from like Jamaica or something. Right, eat one. But this guy, this is probably the worst tasting thing I've tasted since I've been here. Even if I might give you kind of like some life, it's pretty bad. But if it's like anti-cancer or something, I might eat it like once a month. It's pretty strong tasting though, guys. But anyways, let's go take a look at some things that maybe aren't quite as strong tasting up on the top shelf. So up on the top shelf here, we got a few things that are actually growing quite tall. This is probably like pushing 3 feet tall. And this is the shiso, something that I like a lot, also known in Asian cuisine, but most Americans are not familiar with it. She actually propagates it by cuttings, which is actually quite interesting because all mine have come up easily by seed. I like it a lot just due to the nice, deep, rich purple pigments, which have lots of anthocyanins, which are really good for you to eat. So I want to encourage you guys always to pick deeply pigmented foods like blueberries, purple carrots, you know, shiso that's purple. Next here, she has another one. I call this chameleon plant because actually I grow the variegated variety, but this is also known as the fish mint, which have these like heart style leaves that you can eat. It grows as a weed, and that's definitely a really good idea to keep that one in a pot because it can spread out and take over a lot. This guy could also be a spreader, and I mean, some of these Asian vegetables, like, they're literally used to growing in the jungle. They've had to basically survive on their own and survive without getting eaten by all the crazy tropical pests and bugs and diseases and funguses and all this kind of stuff. So they're pretty tolerant, you know, of many of our climates here, and, you know, generally don't get as much bug damage as, like, a lettuce or a kale in your garden. That's yet another reason why I like to grow some of these Asian greens. Anyways, this one's known as the Rao Ram that also can get out of control. It's also a spreader propagated by cuttings, as many of these plants are. I grew that several years. I just found I didn't use it as much, but I want to probably bring it back, you know, because, you know, one of the things I want to tell you guys is that, like, some of these flavors are quite unique, interesting, and different, and it's going to be something learned, especially for most Americans that aren't used to some of these weird bitter flavors, right? But you know, like, Asian people have eaten these for a long time, especially like Wendi. You know, she's eaten these as a child, and this is what she's familiar with. Like, if you grew up eating McDonald's, you probably love McDonald's. I mean, I don't eat McDonald's anymore because it's like GMO and everything. I'm like against factory farmed and like really bad food that's probably going to cause you to get sick. I'm doing the exact opposite, which is like eating plants that'll cause me to get healthy, right? Some of these Asian vegetables. And you have to get used to the flavors, right? And try a little bit. But I want you guys to incorporate them on a regular basis. Not like maybe every day, maybe like use one of these once a week. But at least that way you're getting some of the special phytonutrients and phytochemicals that these plants create, because literally plants, they're just simply chemical factories, right? Based on the soil, based on the bacteria, based on the minerals in the soil, right? Based on the sun, based on the inputs, based on the water they're getting. They create many different chemical compounds, right? A tomato could produce up to 300 different chemical compounds within a tomato plant, right? And think of some of these guys are like highly specialized, and these chemicals are not created in the plant for our benefit, even though the research has been showing that some of these are anti-disease, anti-cancer, anti-high blood pressure,
high blood sugar. You know, these are good for the plant because, you know, that's why the plants are repellent against pests, because of all these phytonutrients that the plant makes to defend itself against nature, whether that's heavy, hardcore sun hitting it, whether that's, you know, some kind of powdery mildew stuff, or whether that's some kind of funky tropical bug that seems to eat everything. So one of the things I'm glad to see Wendy growing here is actually the Ashitaba. So this is actually one of my favorite plants to grow, and she's growing it here in Southern California. I haven't seen that she's growing any actually in the ground, but she has many different Ashitaba plants in the pots, which seem to be growing well, some of which are in just 5-gallon pots. And even this guy behind me is actually going to flower, setting seed. Quite impressive. You know, Ashitaba, based on my research and opinion, is actually quite a beneficial, healthy plant because it bleeds this yellow sap known as a chalcones, which actually I could see her plant bleeding some of that stuff. So I like to, you know, juice the basically celery-like stalks. It's related to an angelica, but it's a special variety. I also like to juice or eat the leaves, whether blended or juiced. I find the taste nice and delicious, but of course it depends on your climate zone. It's also a biennial. She grows them and she'll sell plants to you guys because starting the seeds can be difficult. I do offer some seeds that I grew because I have so many seeds and I can't start every one, but she'll offer you guys, you know, plants, successful germinated seeds and the plants. So actually, let's show you guys real quick where that all happens. So probably the last thing I want to share with you guys outside, because it is actually getting quite dark before we sit down with Wendy, is actually her little greenhouse. So this is where she propagates and germinates different seeds and cuttings of rare plants she finds in different places and grows them out. Not only for her, but also for you guys. One of the things Wendy does, unlike me, because like I got so many viewers and so little time and so much to do, you know, part of what she does is actually she teaches people about gardening, but also she helps them by getting some of these rare genetics, some of these rare plants, seeds, and fruiting trees and whatnot. And so like one of the main things she likes to focus on is get out the Gynera procumbens. You know, I think the Gynera procumbens or the longevity spinach is like a good gateway Asian vegetable to start growing, to kind of get you into Asian vegetables, because it's like has such a mild flavor and really rich and good, delicious, but also some good major important health benefits. So she actually has like little trays. They look like oversized like dishwashing pans, but actually they're dishwashing pans from like a commercial restaurant supply store to kind of create a nice environment and a moist environment for the plants, a humid environment, but also to, you know, save the runoff water so she doesn't water too much, so that just doesn't run down and evaporate. She's using every last drop and she's being as conscious as she can with water. And she waters actually, I'm surprised on how few and little she waters with all these crops here. You know, because some of these are more used to living in the wild, they're not quite as temperamental as other plants that need water on a regular basis. So she waters very infrequently, although she does water every day, but it depends what time of year. And I encourage you guys right now to set your watering timers back. I mean, it's getting cooler now. Don't have to water as much. I mean, that's what I do, you know, generally. Every 2 months I assess, like, okay, John, should you turn up your watering, turn down your watering? Let's save as much water as possible. Because also, let's give your plants the proper amount of water, right? Giving your plants too much water is not good. Giving them not enough water is not good either. Just give them the proper amount so that they grow the best. You're not flooding out the soil, and the soil is not too dry either. Any case, let's go ahead and head inside and sit down with Wendy to share more about what she does and talk to her about how she got into growing all this amazing food, and also why she actually has a YouTube channel to educate you guys about some of these Asian vegetables. So now I'm here with Wendy Fan of Wendyland, and that's her YouTube channel. So Wendy, thanks for having me out to your house today to share with everybody like all your cool Asian vegetables and all your other cool things that you're growing. The first question I want to ask you is, how'd you get into growing all this stuff? I mean, it's not super common that people grow stuff at their house like this.
Yeah, well, my grandfather liked to garden, but he likes growing ornamental things, you know, flowers, things like that. So I started off doing that when I was young. I actually went to the farmer's market with my dad, and I'll have like marigolds and strawberries, things like that growing. And then my grandfather would give me like jasmine and stuff. So I grew flowers for a while, and then I switched up and slowly growing more edibles.
Cool. So tell me about your relationship with some of the edibles that I showed my viewers today, right? Some of these are traditional
vegetables from your culture, right, that most Americans don't simply know about, unfortunately.
Yeah, for sure. I grew up with them. We eat it almost on a regular basis. You know, if it's not a week, if it's not daily, then it's like weekly. We're introducing different kind of fresh, raw herbs, different herbs that pairs really well with food that we eat. Just every meal is always with, you know, generally speaking, it's got a lot of these fresh herbs.
Now, were those eaten for their medicinal or health benefits, or just because of the flavors or traditional flavors that people like or expect?
Well, I think these herbs, a lot of them are Asian, especially the Vietnamese ones. I think it's for flavor, but the more I looked into it, I actually found a lot of medicinal values into it. Like the cooling, the herbs, the yin and the yang herbs, and they pair really well with the food, besides the flavor, and then just learning about how they really bring food in balance and like your energy in your body. So I started taking more interest the more I read into it.
Wow. So what benefits have you seen personally from using some of the different herbs, you know, that you're growing?
A lot, actually. Mostly, I think, especially with my family, I kind of started them growing some things too. And then, like my dad with his blood sugar, he was able to do that with his generic Procommons. He stopped taking his diabetes medication and actually told him to cut back on rice, because a lot of Asians eat a lot of white rice too, and that, and then adding different greens and the herbs, and sometimes with if you have a cold or a sore throat or any kind of common small little problems too, I simply can just go in the garden and pick these, and even with my dog, you know, I see that she's so much better. She survived cancer, I guess I can put it that way.
Because of the greens and things you're growing.
The greens, everything, all organic, everything just, you know, really high quality and a lot of fresh raw foods and medicinal herbs. She gets, you know, she pretty much eats everything that we eat too, so.
Wow, yeah, my dog eats a lot of what I eat, you know, as well. Just the greens, I mean, the leafy greens, that's my channel, Growing Your Greens. And I'm cool that I'm here to share with you guys some Asian, you know, more unique greens that some of them don't even have like even proper English names. So Wendi, I know a lot of people out there, especially this time of year, cold and flu season might be coming up. What are some of the Asian greens that you like to take for cold and flu?
Cold and flu, well, it depends on, generally I think ginger or the galanga would be a really good one for that. And besides that, even expanding to like the Cuban oregano, that's really good for colds, especially coughs. My mom, for some reason, refused to go see the doctor, and she was coughing for an entire year every single night. Yeah, and she just made that with the calamansi, which is another small citrus that grows like pretty much year-round here. It's awesome. So she would steam that, like make a tea with those two together, and the cough just went away. Like, it never returned.
Wow, that's amazing. Like, the power of plants, all the phytochemicals and phytonutrients in the plants. So Wendi, another thing I wanted to talk to you about was actually your YouTube channel. So your YouTube channel is quite popular. You have some top rated videos on certain topics, especially some of the Asian vegetables, which actually I tuned into and watched. Your videos are great. I like them a lot. And I would encourage you guys to check her channel out below, subscribe and check out her videos. But why did you start making YouTube videos? I mean, you didn't necessarily do that for a living, right?
Right. Well, I started off because of the marmos I was selling. Marmos, which are little algae balls that are more for decorative purposes, and there weren't much information online, and I wanted to help my customers out, sending them, you know, more information about it, and then after that I was like, people wanted to see more about it. I was like, well, this is all the information I know about. I didn't know what else I can make, you know, on top of like more videos upon videos of marmos. But then my deep passion is to share, you know, some of like the things that I learned through my journey in health and like family and friends and pets and so on. So I just decided, hey, let's just post something that, you know, like a tea that I was making, like an artichoke tea. And I thought, who's going to watch this? Well, I'm just going to post it anyway. If someone, you know, happens to like it and it could help them out, then great, you know. And it seems like some people were responding to it, so I kept making videos and started sharing my garden. I had no intention of bringing like things that I was growing into my YouTube channel.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So, and you just did that because why?
Because people are like, oh, what else are you growing? Or if I'm talking and then suddenly there's like a banana hanging, like a stuff of banana behind, you know, and they're like, what is that banana? You know, and I'll be like, I guess I can make a video on that, you know?
That's cool. Yeah, so if you guys want a specific video on many of the different items, the different plants I covered, check her channel out, because she probably has a video on it already, and if not, she probably will make one after this video. But yeah, that's really cool that you're doing that to help and educate people. Well, I mean, that's why I started my channel, actually, is because I found a guy in actually Pasadena, here in Southern California, who converted his yard to all raised bed garden. And I'm like, wow, I want to do that. And I tried to find everywhere, like, how did this guy do it? And how are other people doing it? And like, there's no videos on people doing it. I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to make videos to show people what I'm doing. So my first video is like with my lawn, and we're digging it up. So we put the irrigation system in, and slowly but surely you saw me convert my lawn into an all raised bed edible vegetable garden. And since then I just continue to make videos, all kinds of videos now, actually visiting other people's and cool things and learning and teaching you guys cool stuff, because I'm just, once again, sharing with you guys my journey. Like, visiting Wendi today is part of my journey. It's not like I came here to make a video. I came here to, like, talk to her. And actually, I talked to her probably too much so that some of the video ran into the dark before I got to film, because we were just chatting and I was, like, learning about all these cool things she's growing. So, Wendi, I covered some of the plants today in the video, but why don't you go over some of your maybe top five favorite ones real quick for my viewers today?
Oh, sure. I'll start with the Saba snake plant.
Oh, grass?
Snake grass plant.
Right, yeah, so I covered that one.
Yeah, so that one's from Malaysia, and it's really good. It has, like, anti-cancer properties.
Oh, anti-cancer.
Yeah, so... some people say you eat like 200 raw leaves a day, and that would probably be a lot of plants you have to grow for if you are actually trying to fight cancer. But another thing that benefits is for your kidneys, which is really helpful for, you know, especially people that are eating processed food or whatever, right? Or drinking, or it's just everything goes through your kidney is so important. And it's one of the vital organs that... It's not like your liver where it can regenerate cells slowly. Like, your kidney is just slowly, just the function just decreases. It cannot go back to, like, it will not improve. So that's a very important organ. And then I started finding, like, my friend actually, who came with me on at the expo.
To the heirloom.
Yeah, and, you know, she was having that, and she was able to, she doesn't like all that much greens, but she was able to, she was okay with it, you know. She ate it and she was like, oh, it didn't taste like much of anything, you know. And
yeah, the flavor was all right, actually.
Yeah, and then, like, some people have, like, a problem with urination, just, you know, multiple times, just constant urinating, and just eating a few of those leaves, and they suddenly feel like, oh, I forgot, I don't have to go to the bathroom.
Wow, so you don't have to pee as much. I pee so much because I drink a lot of liquid, so I might cut that down.
Perhaps, maybe on a road trip, actually, that would help.
Wow, I think I got to get my girlfriends on those leaves, actually.
That's probably good.
I got to get
anyone.
One of those plants. So how are those plants, how is that plant propagated?
Very easy. It definitely likes humidity and warmth, but indirect sunlight. So you propagate just by the cutting the stem, and you can root them in water.
No way.
In the summer, you can probably start seeing roots showing in that during the whole first 7 days.
Wow.
Yeah.
Cool. So what's another plant besides the snake grass?
Besides the snake grass, I like that bitter leaf.
Oh, the bitter leaf, so the one from Africa. I showed that, like, that has a really strong flavor. Second worst thing I've tasted today. But actually, the other thing I didn't mention, you guys, is actually after you eat it, you know, you get this, like, weird, like, if you ever eat an artichoke heart, like, after you eat an artichoke heart, you get that kind of, like,
aftertaste.
That aftertaste, like, sweet. It was really weird because I was eating it. I ate it, and then we were talking, and I'm like, wait, I taste some aftertaste. Kind of tastes good. So as long as you get over the bitterness, the aftertaste is actually quite cool.
Yeah, it's kind of like reminds me if I were to eat, I guess, like oolong tea leaves or something. It's like bitter at first, but at the end, you start feeling a little bit of sweetness in the back of your throat. Yeah.
So what about that plant? Like, what is that?
That one actually has some, it's cytotoxins that's like actually like your cells just inhibits cancer cells, like carcinoma cells for... reducing risk for like breast cancer. They've done a lot of studies on it. Actually, it helps with that.
Wow.
Yeah. And other than that, it's actually good for wound healing too, and a lot of really good properties in there. You can like mash it up and directly apply it on the wounds, or you can cook it, which is like native to Africa. So they actually do a lot of cooking with it. It's like a a staple there. I mean, oh, wow. It's a tree, and I can grow so much leaves that you can eat, you know.
Wow, it's amazing. That's one that I just learned about today, actually. So how about another one?
Another one. The patty, the rice patty herb.
Oh, yeah, I didn't get to show that one today.
Okay, yeah. I can make a video on that one. Yeah, so that one has a really beautiful fragrance. I really enjoy it.
Yeah, it smells so great.
It reminds me of pineapples. I don't know why, but it's
so flavorful, not that there's a fragrance, but when you eat it too, it's like, it's really floral.
It's exactly, it's sweet and floral, and that citrus note at the end, it's so nice. So that really goes well in, I think, summer salads. I'm thinking with fruit salads and things like that, or in soups. Vietnamese do like a vegetable or a fish broth kind of soup with a sweet and sour spicy soup, and they would add that into it, and it smells amazing whenever you just throw that in hot soup.
Now, I know some of my viewers out there want to get some of these plants, and they can be actually quite hard to find, but certain of these plants, actually, you just buy the plant or the vegetable actually at your local Asian market. So I know the rice patty you could get at Asian market, something like the water spinach, you know, many good Asian markets may have it, and you could start those by the cutting. So you just buy healthy, you know, fresh vegetables that you'd use to eat, and then you just do the cutting. So how would you do that on the rice patty herb?
Rice patty herb really loves humidity. So in Southern California, the air is dead dry, humidity levels literally.
You haven't moved
zero
to Vegas yet. That's like negative humidity.
In the greenhouse, they might love it in Vegas. They actually grow in the rice patties, that's hence the name. So they really love the moisture in the ground and above ground. So to get them started, you can root them in water, but you've got to have a dome or a plastic bag, something over it to trap the humidity. Otherwise, it just roots. I mean, rots.
It just rots. It rots, not roots. That rhymes. Rots and roots.
Yeah.
All right, so what's another...
Another one. I'm so in love with pandan. It's a part of the screw pine family. It has amazing fragrance. A lot of people from Southeast Asia are really familiar with this herb. It's kind of slow growing and sensitive to the cold. But I'm really happy that I can get some growing, and sometimes I can add them. You can make a really wonderful tea with it. It has like a creamy, sweet, some people refer to it as a Asian vanilla smell.
Oh, wow.
This is creamy, sweet, grassy though, a little more on the green grassy side, but it pairs really well with coconut cream.
Oh wow, I have to try that one with coconut cream. I love making it.
Yep, and then you can like color your food naturally green with the juice of that. So you would extract the juice to use that. What you would do.
Oh, cool. Another one I showed actually was the jelly grass, and that's actually what I learned about actually at the expo, Heirloom Expo, when you gave your presentation on some of these Asian greens. So you want to talk more about that one?
Oh yeah, so grass jelly is also one of my top ones that I use around the garden, because it was just so refreshing, especially in the summer. If I feel like I have a sore throat or something, this is such a cooling, because it just also holds so much moisture in there too, right?
The leaves?
The leaves, the juice in the leaves.
Oh, I see.
It's like the pectin and all that. And not only that, when it goes down your GI tract and then it binds with
it's
like cholesterol.
It's like soothing or?
It's soothing. It's so soothing. Like it coats my intestines so nicely or something. It's,
wow.
Like if I ate something wrong, hopefully not that often, but sometimes there's like bad food when you visit people, but I have one of these and it's just so nice and refreshing.
So how's it used traditionally?
Traditionally, it is eaten. In fact, John, make this.
Wow, check it out. I want to show you guys. This looks really cool.
Try.
I don't know if you guys can see that.
Like, the
look,
more
it's
you
like
to show them, it's going to slip
off. Yeah, it's going to slip off. It's like, I don't know if I can get it in my hand. But if you guys see that, I mean, this is a little like Jell-O. Look at that. Watch it wiggle, see it jiggle, smooth
and juicy. When's the last time you had
Jell-O,
John?
What's up?
When's the last time you had Jell-O?
I haven't had Jell-O since I was a kid. Like, I don't recommend you guys eat Jell-O. It's so processed and just junk.
Except for 100% raw Jell-O.
This is 100% raw Jell-O made with the grass jelly.
Grass jelly, sin sum.
All right, I'm going to try that. So why don't you tell more people about the grass jelly?
Yes.
So this is just 100%... grass jelly, just juice that you just left in the fridge to set for how long?
Well, this was set overnight, but actually it only takes about half an hour.
Wow. So half hour you could make your own Jell-O, 100% vegan, no animal byproducts. Wow, and even cuts like Jell-O too. Like, it's totally crazy. Like, here's just a little piece. Alright, I'm gonna try it. You know what? It tastes like jelly. I mean, the consistency. It's so crazy.
Right?
I mean, it flakes off a little bit better. Jello's a little more like plastic.
Chewy, right? Jello's more chewy than gelatin.
This has a really neutral flavor, so how would normally you flavor this if someone wanted to eat it?
Yeah, I personally would add the pandan juice to flavor. That would be really nice. But for someone who, you know, can't get a hold of that herb, you can put some honey or something on top, because Vietnamese traditionally just put it in syrup. Syrup on top. It's like kind of like a drink. But I would like to put chia seeds, or if you're growing flower petals, calendula, because this is like early summer in the springtime calendulas. I mean, these grass jellies grow year round here, so whenever the flowers are in season, I can make these, and it's like a really nice drink.
Yeah, I mean, this is totally crazy. Like, basically the taste is neutral, and so I'm sure I'm getting like some good chlorophyll in here, other nutrients, vitamins and minerals and things in here. It just tastes like
it's
nothing.
It's so
really
silky smooth. It's
amazing.
So I'm going to be making a video to show how to make this. Basically, it is, I throw it in the Vitamix just to get it started, to mash it up with a little bit of water, and then it goes in a bag and you squeeze the juice. And this is what you get.
Wow, it's amazing. Thank you. I've never tried that before in my whole life, and it's amazing. A vegan Jello. So let's go over like one more plant. I think the Gynera procumbens. Or longevity greens. I know you like that one a lot. I've seen it like grown as a weed. You have like all these pots and all these different places randomly. Oh, there's another one.
Yeah, well, certain pots I specifically grow in pots so I can bring to shows sometimes, like when I talk about
and
them
give classes
at my talks
and, stuff.
And sure, you know, like things like that, or with like a family friend or someone that wants to see it, or you know, I can give them at least a good amount to at least to get them started eating it if you really want it to. And it grows so well here. In the winter, it literally stops growing. So you really have to get more growing if you want to have a supply year round. My whole family eats it. My dog eats it. You know, like everybody's eating it, and it's so easy to eat. You know, like some other greens, like say try to introduce the bitter leaf. You know,
yeah,
it's not
luck,
for
yeah.
everyone. It's so good for you, but it's not for everyone. But that you can gotta get them started. It's like lettuce.
It's pretty
better.
Neutral,
yeah. Yeah, but better. So I'm always saying replace that instead of lettuce. Put that in instead.
Yeah, and what I encourage people to do is like just, you know, have a big lettuce salad and then like take out 25% of it, instead replace that with some of these more, you know, Asian vegetables that you may not be familiar with. I mean, an easy one is Gynera procumbens, because it's just like so mild. I mean, I do that. I mean, I have so much of it all the time, so that's what I'm constantly picking and adding to my salad. So what are some of the health benefits of the Gynera procumbens?
That one actually is very good for your blood sugar, your blood pressure, and your cholesterol.
Oh, wow.
It actually has a little bit of that pectin in it too. If I don't know if you've ever blended a lot of it in a bunch. Because it kind of looks like this grass jelly.
Oh wow.
Also,
I'm gonna have to try that one.
Yeah. It's a little, it gelatinizes everything. Like if I throw other greens or fruits or something, and you let it sit there for just 5 minutes, and then I try to like take it out, and then it's just all stuck in the cup, you know, everything just kind of glued together. Yeah.
That's, I mean, natural pectins. I mean, pectins are so good for us, and most people are not eating enough, you know, plant fibers, which is, you know, a pectin.
Yeah, it's probably very soluble, water soluble.
That's cool.
Yeah.
So another thing I want to talk to you about is actually you make some of these plants available to people. So I know the Gynera procumbens, you know, some people may be having a hard time to find them because they are only propagated by cuttings. You know, although my plants go to flower and set flowers and, you know, maybe seeds, Wendy's has too, we haven't found those to be actually viable. So cuttings is the way to go. And you know, you can buy a lot of cuttings online, and the quality can vary widely, unfortunately. I've had many of my viewers, you know, buy cuttings online, and they just never really root it, right? But I'm glad to say that Wendy actually will do the hard work for you. She'll do the rooting, she'll do the cutting, and then she'll sell you nice, developed, established plants that I actually got to take a look at that have nice, really nice roots actually popping out. These guys are ready to be planted, and these are nice, tall plants, not just some, you know, little small cutting with like two leaves or three leaves cutting out. You want to share with people why you started making these cuttings available for people and the plants, actually?
Yeah, well, because it's all for health reasons. You know, I want to get this message of just eating healthier, you know, this message across. And a lot of people are having issues, mainly just because of their diet, a lot of people, you know. And it really seems to be helping people with blood sugar issues. When they struggle with that, they eat these leaves. And raw is always best with these leaves. So it's best if you can grow them, you know. And just getting them started for them just in a very like coconut core pot, they can just pop it in. It's so much easier for people some people are buying these because it's their first time growing something and they're starting it with this.
Oh wow.
Yeah.
So their first thing they ever grew.
Yeah.
Are your generic procumbens plants?
Yeah. And so far I haven't really gotten much complaints.
So. Oh wow. So you grow those in a coconut coir pot that people could just put in the ground and the roots will grow through it, and then the pot will basically compost over time and dissolve away.
Exactly. And then there's no, you know, nothing with fussing, like messing around with it, getting the sensitivity of the plants and transplanting. You know,
oh yeah, when you have to like take out the plastic
pot.
Yeah,
especially if you're a newbie. Mm, yeah.
That's cool. So let's talk about like all these plants are tropical plants. So let's talk about that. If somebody buys a genera procumbens or wants to grow one of these other ones we've seen, like you want to talk about that. I mean, we're here in Southern California, as I said before, they pretty much don't get frosts here.
2 to 4 days out of the year.
You get a frost or it gets like 34 degrees, which is not a frost.
Yeah, technically not. But then with rain, actually some of them did die, some of the genera. But if you plant it closer to, you know, under a tree or just closer to the wall, it gets a little bit protection.
The house,
it does help, yeah.
So for those of us that aren't lucky enough, like me, to live in a place that does frost, how would somebody grow the genera? No, year-round so they could have a leaves.
You actually can grow it quite well. In fact, I tested over winter this year and it stayed in the house for at least like good 6 to 8 months just by the glass window. But
oh, okay.
You do have to fertilize a little more because it might get a little winky when there's not enough sun.
Or put some lights on it.
Put some lights on it. Yeah. So they're happy to be houseplants.
Cool. So yeah, you could grow. I would grow it in a pot, a large pot as possible. And you can just pull it out in the summer and bring it in the winter. If it starts getting too big, do cuttings and then start root your own cuttings and then have more and then plant some outside, have some pots inside in your greenhouse. Have backups. I mean, I always have backups going all the time just so that I'm never going to lose some of these plants.
Exactly.
And depending on where you live, some of the plants might stay alive, like the roots might stay alive over the winter. So like, you know, in my climate where we do get frosts, right? The one I planted next to the wall that I really just kind of probably cut off at the base, and so there's no top growth, but the roots were alive underground. I didn't even mulch it. I probably should have. It came alive, you know, once the springtime hit and it started to warm up. So this may be an option. I don't want to say it's going to work for you, but mulch it heavy and cross your fingers. And you might be lucky too, but the safest way, of course, is grow it as a houseplant. So Wendi, I want to talk more about your growing practices because I know that's important to a lot of people. You know, a lot of people may use chemical fertilizers and things when they're doing cuttings and all these things. How do you grow?
Well, I first start rooting, plants in general or?
Both.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah, a lot of tropical plants do really well rooted in water. Otherwise in very moist soil, but then the humidity has to be the right amount, you know. Always start with in plastic bag, even as cheap as a plastic bag, just covering on top of it. And sometimes I might add a little pinch of the C90 in there.
Oh, the trace minerals.
The trace minerals to help out. And once I get the nice root system growing, then I would pot them. And I would just put really good, you know, stuff in that, like the rock dust, the non-GMO compost, worm castings, and really good quality potting soil in there, and seaweed extract, which actually I started making my own extract. I guess I sit some really nice seaweed in the water and water the plants.
Oh, cool. Yeah, seaweed extracts are actually quite valuable. So Wendi, one of the last things I want to ask you about is actually the Maramo, which actually got you started making your videos. So that was like your first video. What is a Maramo? I've never heard of this before.
Maramo, it's also called, aka moss ball, but it's actually a type of algae. It's not even a moss. Grows super slow in the ocean or some lakes that they found in Japan. They started as being like pet rocks, but these are like pet, I guess, little green balls or living, you know.
Pet algae balls.
Pet algae balls. You literally can name them and kind of pet them and play with them.
Oh, wow. Like, and that's what they look like.
That's what I look like.
Check it out. This is like, looks like a ball of moss.
Bouncy.
Oh, they bounce?
Well, and the light, when there's sunlight, they kind of float up and then it'll create these air bubbles like oxygen.
But you can't, like, here, I'll pull one out here.
You can, yeah.
But I don't want to squish it or anything.
They're not all that fragile.
Oh, they're not, really? No. Oh, wow, impressive. Right? I mean, I don't want to, like, mess it up or anything, but this is pretty crazy.
It's, like, fuzzy and...
And they kind of just float in water. So how do you take care of these guys?
These guys are really simple. This is, like, super, like, easy to do. You just got to put it in filtered water. And a bit of sun or bright space, that's about it. If you want to nourish it, you can add a tiny pinch of sea salt for trace minerals. But other than that, it's pretty happy just being in water.
And then you should change the water out pretty regularly, right?
I always recommend about once every 1 to 2 weeks, but it depends if you let it sit around. Obviously, if it kind of gets, the water gets cloudy, then you really want to change the water. But regularly, once or twice a month is fine.
And you shouldn't use like chlorine water, right?
Definitely not. So always use filtered water. You can just use the tap water that's been filtered. That's what I use.
Sure. And like these are algae, so I think many algae are edible, some are not. And seaweeds are a type of more advanced algae. They're edible. So do you eat these?
I did come across an article saying that you can eat them, but I wasn't sure if I read that correctly. So I've never.
All right. Well, here's the thing. So, like, I saw she had these, and then I, like, totally spent, like, a couple hours to research these.
A new thing I might be able to eat.
A new thing I could eat, and that you guys could grow literally just in water. But the bad news is these guys don't grow very fast. So, like, this big one here, it looks pretty large. I don't know if you guys could see that one, this one right here. You've had that for how long now?
About 4.5 years.
4.5 years, and then these guys on this side are, like, how old are these guys over on this side, these small ones?
These ones are probably about, I think, 3 years or so.
Oh, so these are, they're kind of old already.
But they are, yeah. I got them in different sizes when I started, collecting them. And in their natural habitat, they only supposedly grow up to 5 millimeters per year.
Oh, wow. So that's small, really, so this is not any kind of like major food you'd be growing to like eat on any regular basis then.
Absolutely not. It's probably it's a delicacy.
Yeah. Anyways, in some countries they have certain cultivars of this algae they eat. I'm pretty daring and, I don't recommend trying this at home. Do so your own risk, but I like to try crazy stuff. So what we got is we got the piece of that algae stuff, Moramo. And I'm going to eat this. This is like clean water, right?
We pesticides only use ring. Clean water and it's washed thoroughly. So it
doesn't really smell like anything. Oops, and I'm going to, if you squeeze it, it's kind of like a sponge, right? You
can really squeeze it out. It smells like a fresh mown lawn, I'd say. Right?
Oh, it smells like a lawn. So I'm squeezing out the water.
Lawn. Yeah, I cleaned it really well. I never handle it with chlorine water.
So this is like, it's kind of like a sponge, but like really dense. Okay, I'm kind of scared, but I'm doing this at my own risk. It's on the camera. Oh man, it's like, you wouldn't really want to eat this.
You like, just ate away like 3 years old.
This is 3 years old?
Well, I mean, naturally, if they grow that slow, if they take that long to grow.
All right, so that's like eating like a cotton ball. Like, it doesn't,
I'll try this again?
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe you blended it up. I mean, I'm pretty much just chewing it in my mouth. It's just getting the water out.
I mean, if you're talking about chlorophyll, chlorophyll.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to say I pass on eating the Moramos. You should grow them as pets, or if you got kids, it's probably like kind of cool. Yeah. But yeah, I've tried it. I just recommend eating like regular seaweed and other edible algae, such as chlorella, spirulina, and the blue-green algae. Yeah. So I think we're coming to the end today, Wendi. Any final comments or words of wisdom you'd like to share with my viewers out there?
Just if you've never started your garden, just try growing something. And there's lots of easy to grow herbs and even, a few that John has shared in this video. They may look like they're harder to grow than you think, but if you keep it indoor, you can get them started and you can always grow things in different locations in the house to kind of, test out and see which spot it likes best and just get started.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I recommend, especially some of you guys that live in, more southern climates, right? Here, Southern California.
Take the advantage.
South Texas, Southwest, Florida, Alabama, all these southern states that have like nice, hot, humid, right?
that climate simulates basically Southeast Asia. So you'll be able to grow some of these things super simple, super easy, whereas you might have a hard time growing lettuce. Some of these Asian vegetables might even take over your yard.
And it probably will.
So be careful with some of them. Grow in a raised bed, grow them in pots if you just want to make sure, biggest pot as possible, so you guys can grow more stuff and be more successful, right? I mean, I think that's really important in this day and age. We're trying to grow like northern crops in southern gardens. That just doesn't work. You know, some of these plants I planted in my girlfriend's parents' garden in Houston did amazing. Some of these plants do amazing for me in Las Vegas. I've seen some of these plants grow amazing in places like South Florida, you know, I'm sure like Louisiana, Georgia, Alabama, all these places are going to do great. So you've got to try some of them. Challenges sometimes getting them. So yeah, check out your local Asian market. Some good Asian markets may have some of these rare things that you can start from cuttings really simply and easy. Check out Wendi's channel to learn more about these Asian greens that we talked about. She has videos on propagating them and starting them and all this kind of stuff. She's a wealth of information. I'm so glad I got to come by today, Wendi, and thank you for inviting me over.
Thank you so much for coming. So, it was so much fun.
If somebody wants to learn more about you, your website, get some of these plants, the Moromo balls for their pets, not for eating, and watch your YouTube videos, how could they do that?
Yeah, you just search for Wendiland, W-E-N-D-I, like ice cream, L-A-N-D, one word. And yeah, you can find it on YouTube or just wendiland.com, where I have things available to you guys and a blog and stuff. So.
Awesome. Great. Yeah, check out. I'll put the links down below. And if you guys enjoyed this episode, hey, please be sure to give it a thumbs up next time I come to Southern California trying to visit Wendi and make more videos, because I mean, I just covered like literally like 0.1% of what she has. She has so many things growing and I just did not have the time to do it because we were probably talking about too much. Also be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on any of my new and upcoming episodes that are coming out about every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Also be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,300 videos at this time teach you guys all aspects on how you guys can grow your own food at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. Until then, remember, keep on growing.